All right, so hello everyone. Again, it's nice to see some of you. I met some others on the different webinars we did with the team. And I am happy to join you today to talk about the startup guide for a STEM Center project implementation. My name is Mohammed Abdelaziz. I introduced you at the beginning. Here's more information about myself. I'm a medical doctor. I also specialized in English literature and civilization in Algeria. I'm a TESOL certificate and PCL licensed trainer. I can define myself as a teacher first and a teacher educator. I've been working with Word Learning for 13 years on international education and development programs. Currently, I am leading the efforts under the project of the STEM Discovery Center in Saudi Arabia. I am a math and astronomy lover, and I am a cognitive neuroscience enthusiast. So this is a little bit about myself. So in our presentation today, we're going to touch on these 7 areas for the startup of any STEM center. First is defining the objectives for the STEM center, engaging others, engaging members in the community, and under others, there are a lot of categories of stakeholders that we go into detail in the presentation. Step 3, I would is thinking logistics for attracting participants to being students and or teachers, planning activities, finding support and sustaining programming. It is noteworthy that some of these areas will be talked about in details with my other colleagues, and I will be referring to those topics with the presentation. All right, so there is something I need to clarify first. So when we're talking about a center, it doesn't have to be a formal big center where we are holding STEM activities, but under center, it can be what I refer to here with the word center, can be a club, can be a corner, can be a small space, can be even like a mobile caravan with no specific building. So all of this will fall in the following slides on the presentation under the word center with a small c. All right. How we're going to go through the presentation, I'm going to explain the steps for startup that I chose to include in the presentation. And at the end of each step, I will include a checklist question for you guys. And I would like you to use the chat box. If you're comfortable with that, just to jot down some answers, the first ideas that come to your mind after the question is asked. Okay. Perfect. So the first step is defining objectives to measure success. So the very first question we need to ask is, why are we starting or running a STEM center? I understand that some of you are already running a STEM center or probably will be starting a STEM center soon. So the first question is like, why? The reasons for starting the STEM center can be varied. From one place to another, from one team to the other. They can be very like basic. For example, under the list of possible objectives here, I have awareness. student achievement, some STEM centers has as a goal to raise the student attainment in their school programs. It can be to prepare teams for competition and challenges. It can be to link students to industries and to implement some career orientation or career planning programs and so on. So defining the reason, having the end in mind at the very beginning is important. It's most helpful if the objective is smart, specific, measurable, attainable, result-oriented, and time-bound. And I'm assuming that you're familiar with smart objectives. Now, what's more important for me here in this first step is not just why you're starting a STEM center, but why do we have to ask the question why? So why? If we are clear about our vision for the STEM center, we'll have focused planning along like throughout the year. This planning, that's not, I would say that's not fixed and rigid, but that is continuously changing based on feedback and evaluation we have. That evaluation, that feedback that we have does not just come out of the blue, but it is a comparison of our results, our products, our outcomes against what we have set for ourselves or against our objectives. So that
Mohamed, we can't hear you anymore. Can you hear us?
So we cannot hear.
Yes, I think we might have lost Mohamed for a minute. I'll send him a message.
In some countries where we have people like
Mohamed, we lost you about a minute ago. If you could repeat maybe the last few things you said.
Okay, sure. Thanks, Deepa. Thanks, Hayley. So I mentioned maybe the second section is important to why do we need to have a to define our objectives. Point one is to have a focused planning. If we have focused planning, we have effective results. Also, if we have a clear vision, then we can get others involved more easily. Involving others, we go under the second step that we'll discuss in a minute. And also in some countries, we need some authority approvals. If we have a plan that is clear and that is shareable, then we'll be able to easily get some government approvals. Defining also a plan will inevitably make us create a clear success framework. And having a clear success framework allows us to rejoice in our achievement, rejoice in our, I would say, completion by the end of the chunks of our programming. So the other question that would guide the objectives and the vision for the STEM Center is the center's focus. So what is your STEM Center's focus? Now, while I am discussing this question, I would like you to think alongside me, like, what is your STEM Center's focus? I will explain the focus ranges and think about your experience, your STEM Center or STEM initiative, and where do you think it falls? So the focus for STEM Center programming, it can be narrow. Narrow focus implies focus on a particular STEM specialty. Usually it is based on community priority or need after we have done a needs analysis. It is easier, the narrow focus is easier because we'll have smaller activities. We can have intensive courses, but we do not go into longer programs and longer term courses. It may need low resources. And also we can have like trainers will be confident in implementing this type of narrow focus programming. Conversely, the wide focus has a broader range of subjects. So there are many subjects to many workshops to teach, and there is a clear interdisciplinarity in our programming. An example for that, if we take aerospace or aeronautics, we have physics, math, chemistry, engineering, design, and technology all in one in that course. This is an example of a wide focus programming. So when you see these two extremes, then you can think about your center's focus. Before asking you to jot anything down, I'll move to the horizontal the horizontal line, which is the immersion. So what is your STEM Center's level of immersion? Or I would say, not what is it, but how are you planning on having your center's STEM immersion? Under this spectrum, we have four immersion levels: exploratory, introductory, partial immersion, and full immersion. If you ask me what these are, I would start by the exploratory level. For the exploratory level of immersion, we have extracurricular opportunities, workshops, And these workshops are standalone and conducted outside the traditional school day. So remember, it is extracurricular and they are standalone. Almost there is no link to the school curriculum. The introductory level, though, has some link to the school curriculum. We still have extracurricular opportunities that happen usually in after school setting. However, it has a focused content areas and focused specialties. It is based on problem solving and project based instruction. And usually it is, it focuses also on product development. So students by the end of the workshops or the courses will produce something, will produce a project. So this is the introductory level. The partial and the full immersion are a little bit focused more on the integration with the school experience and curriculum. So for the partial immersion, it is school-based interdisciplinary instruction. So it focuses a lot on the curricula and how the workshops link to the curricula. The full immersion is completely cross-curricular. In this APIS level, it's project-based learning drives the curriculum actually. And the full immersion classroom is actually a 21st century workplace environment. So these are the different levels of immersion. So what I would like you to think about is, where do you place yourself in the midst of this? So on this matrix, I would like you to think, what is your center's focus? Or at least what are your plans for your center's focus? And what is the level of immersion you have? For example, here we have the STEM Discovery Center in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, that is soon to open. It falls in the area where you see, so it is, the focus is wide because we'll be delivering a lot of specialties, STEM specialties, a wide range of STEM specialties. Even the interdisciplinarity is put into the forms of workshops that are standalone. On the immersion level, it's at the exploratory level. So it's not partial immersion, it's not full immersion. There will be links to the curricula, school curricula, but there will be, but it remains extracurricular after school enrichment programs. So I would like you to think about this, even if you do not share it now on the chat box, think about what is your level of focus and what is your level of immersion currently, or the way you plan that to be. I just put the chat box here so that I'm able to see if any answers there. Okay, yeah, so I can see some of you guys, like Department of STEM Education, has already an answer for that, for the focus is So working on teacher education and research in the field. All right, and for the immersion level, it's towards partial immersion. Thank you. So now, after we find our objectives, the impact. So measuring your impact from the outside throughout. So don't worry if you haven't started thinking about objectives and a success framework, it's never too late. So you can start this any moment. Probably you will be missing on some data, but it's never too late to do that. You can include partners, you can include students, teachers, and also the leadership in this process so that they can provide the positive areas and the strengths and the areas of improvement in your programming. Now, the question that we ask is, why do we assess? Why do we employ this success framework or assessment? It is, first and foremost, is to check if the objectives are achieved, but also in some environments where resources are not available, we also need to make sure that the resources are used effectively. Assessment also helps us inform our strategic decisions when we have our reflection, pause and reflect sessions during the implementation period. But also it will help us showcase our success for funders, for community partners and parents. Something I'm in love with is the reflective practice. The assessments side for teachers and students through the format of reflective practice will help enhance our programming and will help improve quite extraordinarily the offerings that we have under our STEM center. I will stop here for talking about assessments and measuring success, how to do that, and for more details, stay tuned for our upcoming session, Assessments with Dr. Peter Weinberger. All right, so here we end the first step, which is defining objectives to measure success. And my checklist question for you is, think about your objectives and how you will measure impact. So the question I just asked in the previous slide is, what is your STEM center's focus and level of immersion? This is basically the question that takes into just level of immersion. Think about it. You don't have to share an answer with me, but at least write it down on a piece of paper, type it on a Word document or you will have a list of checklist questions to know where you are on the startup guide. All right. Okay. So if we're good with this first step, we're going to move to the next one, which is engaging others. So please feel free to write something on the chat box so that I can move on. Okay. So I have the threshold of two answers on the chat box. So if we reach that, I will move to the next slide. Are we good to go? Okay, so I have been out here saying we measure impact after the program evaluation. Good. And Igerine is saying, yes, we can move on. Good. So I reached my threshold. All right. Thank you, guys. Now, engaging others, engaging stakeholders. The word others here is so, if I were able to put it like more bold-faced, darker, I would. Because others, there will be a lot to discuss under others. I organized the ideas here under three categories: leadership, mentors, and supporters. So if you start with leadership, how to engage leadership or who takes leadership at the STEM Center, it is key that that this person need to be an individual or individuals with a driving force. It's important to have this driving force because it is the force that will engage all the other people in a collaborative way to share responsibility and also to include more individuals with a range of expertise who work towards the success of the STEM Center through planning activities, ideating, so having new ideas for activities, for the curriculum, for the courses, making sure that the logistics are in space, ensuring kits and space are available. Also on the financial side and the budgeting side. Also under this collaboration format, training the staff and training the new members is important. And this is one of the roles that we need this leadership team to have. In addition to all of that is reporting. Reporting not just for funders, but also reporting for success, the point that we just mentioned in the previous point. Okay, the second after leadership is the mentors. The mentors are the force, if you're familiar with the force. They are the engine, they are the driving force of the STEM Center, are the mentors. What do we mean by mentors? Partly it's a small m, that means these people who will be guiding learners. They may be volunteers, but not necessarily volunteers. But I underlined here the word willing. It is important that the interest and the motivation comes from within. So these are volunteers willing to offer ongoing support. These mentors are an invaluable source of expert advice on education fields, on career orientation or career, I would say, career readiness for younger students. They bring into the STEM Center real life context, or they provide the linkages between real life context and the activities we have at the STEM Center. They are teaching assistants when it comes to teaching kids based on their areas of expertise. They bring in fresh ideas and they serve as role models for the younger students. More importantly, they are helpful when it comes to peer-to-peer support, consolidating learning. What I mean by this is that these mentors will be a role example, that's true, but themselves, they are developing their expertise in one of the STEM areas. So while they're learning, they share and they help the others, not just in their specialty, but with also whatever they know, with their knowledge and skills for one workshop or more than one workshops, if they have that knowledge and skill. They can also help with event organization. They can be audience for presentations, judges for competitions, and they represent the STEM Center outside the center. So they are the center ambassadors. Now, given all these invaluable or extraordinary heroes here, how do we get them? How do we find this treasure? The first idea that came to my mind is word of mouth. And I think word of mouth here is the secret map, because it's word of mouth that transmits or conveys the motivation and the interest these people have. So these STEM mentors can be STEM experts. So they are specialized in STEM already, or they can be STEM subject enthusiasts. And usually you find them studying more on their own, so that they develop their skills in one or more STEM specialties. They can be science and technology students as well at the level of university, but who go that extra mile to develop their expertise in that specialty. So this is one category of STEM mentors. The other one is actually, we do not find them, but we can help them, help them like be STEM mentors through the teacher training programs that we have. So they can be teacher training graduates, and they can just STEM Center alumni. So they participate in workshops and they develop this passion about one activity or the other. They go to the depths and to the advanced levels of this workshop, and then they are able to teach others. One last category are STEM industry ambassadors. What I call here ambassador is the capital A. So these are also STEM enthusiasts who are already employed in STEM fields, but they are willing to offer support to the center, to the students, or to the teachers. Right. So this has been the second category of under others. And now, what is important to know is that the mentors, we need to keep and nurture the force. We need to keep the mentors. So it's not just that, yes, they are willing to do activities and to participate fully at the STEM Center, but we need to engage them and keep them engaged during the period of our programming. By doing what? Valuing their contribution, always and forever. By offering professional experience opportunities, for example, allowing them to conduct research, giving them a space for their project building activities, maybe even creating internship levels, internship opportunities for them, or providing internship placements with other partners, inviting them to networking events and provide them with recommendations when needed to continue to get internships, to get a job somewhere else, or even to continue their studies or to apply for a scholarship. involve them within the center networking events. When you say in center networking, it's at the makerspace or the STEM hub space inside the center, where there is a variety of members, students, teachers, STEM teachers, other teachers, enthusiasts, curious members, and also mentors from different specialties. So this networking is important. We do not see it, but once these members are at the center, we'll see the positive impact it has on everybody. Lastly, but not least, encourage their soft skills development. So this goes like they are developing their soft skills through the efforts they are doing at the STEM Center, but drawing their attention to that, and through either just drawing their attention or through their reflection sessions will be important so that they can see the progress they are having in their soft skills or profiles. If there are any continuous professional development workshops like teacher training and skill up hub programs, include these members in these programs. All right, so yeah, so this is the second category of the others to engage. And the third category is supporters and community engagement. I will stop here because we'll have also this with my colleague, Dr. Deepa Shrikantaya. So stay tuned for the upcoming session on community engagement with Deepa. All right, so here I end the second step of engaging others. My checklist question for you is to think about your collaboration spheres and name, write down, or type in at least 2. Mentors, 2 technicians, 2 helpers, 2 trainers, or 1 of each, like 1 mentor, 1 volunteer, 1 teacher you can think of now. And you would like to just think about, you don't have to share, but think about 2 people from these categories, even supporters, individuals, and organizations, and write it down somewhere. If you have done that, please write on the chat box and let me know so that I can continue. You can think of more than 2 people or 2 entities, but at least you need to think about 2 mentors, or 1 mentor, 1 teacher, 1 volunteer, and 1 technician, 1 supporter. Okay, so if you have done that, please write in the chat box, say done, so that I can move on to the next startup point. Yeah. Okay. Well, great. Okay, I have more than my threshold. 6 or 7 answers. Very good. All right. So moving on. The third startup step is thinking logistics. So 2 questions I think when it comes to logistics is where, and maybe you're thinking about the other question, which is when. All right, so where? Thinking about the space options for the STEM Center, before identifying the space, we need to think about what types of activities we want to include at the STEM Center. And based on that answer, how much space is needed for those activities. How we can have access to the STEM equipment at this specific location. Do we have storage for that STEM equipment? Right, are we able to secure a reserved venue for our STEM activities? So as you can see here, guys, space options and questions about identifying the space, they all go back to the objectives or the objective of the STEM Center or STEM program. So if that is identified, it will help us very easily think about the activities and the logistics in general. Okay, why we talked about securing a reserved venue, because there will be a space that is needed for planning, for making, capital M here, and for inventing. This is what we call in the Algiers STEM Center and Riyadh STEM Center, what we call the maker space. It's that hub, that space where planning, where students are actually able to invent, to freely make, to bring their projects to life, and for teachers to plan for their sessions and to test their even lessons, to ask questions, to get answers, and so on. So this is the main space for the STEM Center. However, based on the objectives or the focus on your STEM Center programming, probably you wouldn't need like a fixed venue, but that all depends on your objectives. Another question, important question that you ask when it comes to the location is the health and safety procedures and risk and security assessment. So this is really important to think about before finalizing a space acquisition. Yes, so this is the last point, is center focus dependent. So thinking about the space is very center focus dependent. So remember the questions of center focus and level of immersion. All right, the other question, as you have guessed, is when. That goes with logistics. So when do we want to do our programming? Remember, in most of the activities that are extracurricular, this happens after school. So most of the programs are happening in the evening, probably in the late afternoon or in the evening. So when thinking about the evening sessions, we also need to think about pickup, transportation arrangements, and personal safety for our students and our teachers. Mentors as well. Thinking about time is the workshop length. Usually under the exploratory level, each session is from 1.5 to 2 hours long. The course sessions, however, are they, especially those at the introductory level, are the same length, but it's just like we'll have more sessions. If the course's length is 6 weeks, all workshop sessions under that course will remain the same, maximum 2 hours. Another question we need to think about when thinking about the when is the volunteer mentor schedule. If we have our volunteer mentors running activities, so we need to think about their schedule. And based on that schedule, we build our forms, application forms for students so that they can apply for the session we have. Luckily, we have our students free during the school breaks and during weekends. So this is also important to take into consideration while thinking about when to organize workshops and courses. Right. The other question when it comes to logistics is equipment and funding. It's worth mentioning that we can start in a STEM center with really limited resources. We just need to make sure that we are choosing the right activities. We can even have equipment loaned from partners if we have partners who already have the equipment. And we can follow a progressive model from low to no equipment to specialized kits. And usually this is, I believe, in my opinion, this is the process so that we can start strong. For example, we can start with the hour of code, so we learn coding. In the presence of computers, we'd be able to do that.
Hi, Mohammed. I don't know if you can hear me, but we lost you again. I'll send him a message.
Students will be able to use very low resources using papers.
And, Mohammed.
Yes, Haley.
We lost you for about 30 seconds. If you could go back about 3 pictures.
All right. Right. Yeah. So. Thank you. So the progressive model here, the example I'm explaining is the we can start very low from learning coding and computer science unplugged, and then moving to workshops that where we can have some materials, but that are very inexpensive to provide, like chemistry and curiosity machine. So we'd be using some like tongue depressors, glue, paper, card paper, like cardboard and all. Then if we move to the next one, for example, this is the maker camp activities. It will use some electronic components, but not very expensive components, like, for example, we would find for the Arduino. The next one is the Arduino, so we need the Arduino boards and some of the electronic components. And then by the end is, for example, the Lego robotics kits or the make block robotics. So this progressive model, like starting from low resources to getting actually the grants or the funds to get some really maybe expensive, more or less expensive kits like the Lego robotics kits. So another question we, the other point under equipment and funding is where to find funding. Getting some funding will broaden the programming options. We can get business one-time donations, in-kind equipment, or ongoing contribution in the form of grants or of grants actually, and we will be able to get the materials that we need. There's another way that we can secure funding is through a fee-for-service model, where we can still subsidize some of the costs for the workshops for the students, but also we can offer scholarships when it comes to disadvantaged programs. We'll stop here with the equipment and funding. How to secure funding? Now stay tuned also for our upcoming session, philanthropy with my colleague Sean Jones in the upcoming days. All right, so my checklist question for you under this step of thinking logistics is, when you think about logistics, from exciting locations to resourcing and health and safety, so can you think about two ways, or at least like two ways you can secure funding for low resources workshops? So think about two ways you can secure funding for low resource workshops. Examples we can have like computer science unplugged or curiosity machine or chemistry, for example. Can you think of two partners or two funding sources in general? So if you have the answer to this question. Okay, good. Monica is done. Very good. Perfect. So remember, I'm asking here for you to think about two. The idea is so that you get yourself thinking about this startup point, but later, like after the session in your strategic planning sessions, you can go back to these startup checklist questions and you can develop them even further. Thank you for the guys who just wrote on the chat box. Okay, next step is attracting participants. How and who to recruit. think about your objectives. Again, you see, we always go back to the end in mind, to the first step. Think about your objectives, and then you will be able to get answers to who is eligible to join your activities. You can get answers to your selection criteria if you have a subscription level, high level of subscription. Encourage specific age groups for specific programs if your objective is for that specific age. Encourage girls and students underrepresented in STEM subjects to consider STEM fields. Also, is one of your objectives is inclusion, and support students with interest in STEM subjects from all the categories above.
Mohammed, we lost you again.
Programming and
hi, Mohammed.
Yes, Ellie.
Sorry, can you go back to the start of the slide?
This one?
Yes. That's about where we lost you.
All right. Yeah. So attracting participants is the question is how to spread the word. While doing that, we need to think about where to look for information, where they look for information, not just students, but also their parents. Whether an outreach event would generate interest, for example, if that does, then and it's worth going down that road. Probably you could think about planning outreach event for students, for teachers, for students and parents, or for just parents. Also, another important question is what would appeal to the target youth. Remember, what would appeal to them is what would make them curious. It's what would engage them. And this is how we actually get the students that we need, students who are engaged, not students who are obliged to come to the STEM Center. Another a point to think about is how supporters could help and whether enrollment process is clear and easy, because it would be a handicap, an obstacle, if the enrollment process is cumbersome and or is difficult to actually to go through. Now, do we stop at spreading the word and getting participants? No, we need to retain those participants. It's true that in exploratory level, at an exploratory level, participants usually attend workshops, participate in workshops, and it's done. The 2 hours are spent. They learned about, let's say, Arduino electronics, but then they go home. But our goal is not just to let them go, but to keep them in there, to make them curious about the other workshops. So it's always important to have an open space where what we call in our current program, the maker space, where the other participants like pass through. They will see what the others are building there. They can talk to them and they are curious. They want to come again to the STEM Center to learn this workshop or the other workshop. So this is important. The other point I mentioned here is to create a sense of belonging or sense of community, sense of identity through the programming. One very simple thing is to create email addresses for these students, you know, that has the name of the center, for example. It will give them this sense of belonging somewhere, and this will help them and will push them actually to participate in more programming. when thinking about participants, it is important to think about the variability and the inclusivity perspective. So very quickly, I go through this because it's again another area where my colleague Deepa will actually discuss. So attracting members from disadvantaged backgrounds, it's important to understand that some students will have this perception that STEM is male dominated and it's middle class. Students from disadvantaged backgrounds with lower science capital may think that STEM is not for them. So me, like myself, I did not think about this a lot until I was introduced to the science capital. And then I realized that I was missing a lot on this understanding of the science capital and how some students, even students, for example, in my environment who didn't go in high school to the scientific stream, but they went onto the letters stream, they had this perception that STEM is not for them. So at the STEM Center, we need to make sure that we break this myth. And how do we do that? How do we close this STEM skill gap? Is making sure that our communication reflects the diverse groups, gender balanced also groups and settings, increase access to and interaction with role models. This is an important point because usually these models, like, they visualize STEM as accessible and relevant for everyone. And it is important, and students, as they consider their role models as important people doing STEM, so they would be convinced that whatever they share with them is actually true. So they would start bridging that STEM skills gap. Members, in addition to the disadvantaged students who are from disadvantaged backgrounds, we have also inclusion of girls and the inclusion of participants with special education needs. For inclusion of participants with special education needs, we'll focus in our programming on universal design for learning practices that will include, but not limited to, group work, clear instructions, multiple means of representation, making sure to label items, to have wall displays, to know where to position STEM learning kits and materials, to make sure everything is accessible to the students, and to include multiple means of engagement to raise the students' interest in the STEM activities. Okay, so my other colleagues will have, like, more details for you on the first question, how to recruit participants. Stay tuned for our upcoming session on marketing essentials with our colleague Lauren Berlach, and how to implement inclusive practices. That will be an upcoming session with Dr. Deepa Shrikantaya on universal design for learning. So there will be a lot of rich content in the future to look out to. All right, my checklist question for you is about attracting participants. Think about attracting participants and think about 2 strategies to implement. Okay, so think about 2 strategies to implement so that you can apply so that you can attract participants. Okay, if you can think of at least two strategies, please write down on the chat box. Okay, so thank you, Binod, Monica. All right, okay. So let's move on to the plan and activities. So the first four steps are actually the steps with like a lot of content. Planning activities is the part where we start thinking about implementation. So top tips for planning activities, make sure you plan ahead at least 3 or 6 months ahead of time so that your schedules and your plans are shared with the participants or with prospective students and teachers. Start strong. What does it mean? What does this mean? Start strong. Start with workshops that you feel confident with and then move to challenging activities. You do not have just to start on a wide range of activities just to have variety, and then you end up doing those at a low level. So start with activities, workshops that you feel confident with, and then move to the challenging ones. And usually, if you start with a splash, which is a fun, high impact activity, that will help you to hook participants in the programming. Building a teamwork spirit is important also for during this planning, during planning activities. And the last important point that as teachers we always think about is the class profile. So think about, remember that attendance is voluntary, so keep it fun. Make sure that the programming is interest-based and applications for workshops are also interest-based. And whenever possible, especially for older students, make linkages to industry and careers. Okay. The point before last is work towards a competition. A fair or an Olympiad. Why? Usually working towards this goal where the students are going to showcase their knowledge and skills is engaging. It gets them to work hard and to collaborate even more in order to prepare for that competition, for that challenge, or even for that fair where they can showcase their projects. And lastly, encourage reflection practice because it is a cycle. We're based our plan activities on the experiential learning cycle. So every time reflect in order to improve on our practices. So workshops and courses. Again, I'm not gonna go into a lot of details here because if we want to think about our workshops and courses, we need to go back to the first four sections or startup points, the objectives, the target audience, the STEM centers, the STEM center mentors and trainers, and the equipment and resources. So we need to think about all of this before actually we start developing a plan. Developing plans with a STEM center can be a one-time workshop, or it can be a longer term courses that are specific on some STEM subject. In some cases, based on your objective, you can also organize STEM fairs or competition or camps, and you can develop a plan for that. But at the rudimentary level, it is either one-time workshop at an exploratory level or longer-term courses at an introductory level, focusing on one STEM specialty. Okay. In some offerings, and also based on your objectives, we can offer programs based on age groups. So here in this example, I gave two example age groups from 7 to 11 years old and from 12 to 18. So from 7 to 11, it's more of a fun, students will, or pupils will have fun exploring STEM. The age 12 to 11 is what we call innovation level. Is we retain that sense of fun, but the students, we start introducing the students to real world context. All right, so probably you're familiar with some of these activities that we can plan on engineering, robotics, electronics, programming, and science discovery. So there are plenty of activities for STEM that we can have. And my checklist question for you is about your plan. Are you planning an exciting program of activities? What age groups, what type of activities, workshops or courses? You don't have to write anything down, just think about it. Think about the age groups you're serving. and think about what type of activities, either workshops, one-time workshops, or longer-term courses, or both. It can be something that you're already doing or something that you're planning to do. Okay. All right. Okay. So now moving to the next stage is finding support and sustaining programming. So I will not, again, for finding support, two of my colleagues will be digging deeper and in this point, so I'm not gonna include all of details here, but I wanted to say that the STEM Center itself provides support, the Global STEM Network provides support through the toolkits, the webinars, and the networking events. Local industry can provide supports as well, and we can find a lot of STEM materials online. If you're doing any professional development programs, that will provide support for mentors, for teachers, and for a continuous, I would say, teaching development or professional development at the STEM Center. My colleague, Herman Gomez, will be presenting on developing partnerships, so stay tuned for this upcoming session. All right, I'm gonna jump the checklist question for finding support. But if you're interested, I can always share that with you. Now, the last startup point, which is sustaining programming, this is important because it gets the wheel turning. So once your center is set up, make sure you keep momentum and interest and plan for ahead for everyone in order to see what you're doing. And some points to consider is to run outreach events, always include students and teachers' feedback. Make sure that reflection sessions are run. Make sure that you have a comfortable, relaxed, stress-free, fun-filled atmosphere at the center. While you are doing that, you apply for funder support and you raise the center's profile on social media. The other point to consider for sustaining programming is what we're doing right now. The STEM Center partners, the STEM centers in Algeria, the STEM Center in Egypt, and the STEM Center in Saudi Arabia, like create one network to link up with in order to join in planning or in sharing maybe equipment, in sharing a knowledge base that will be helpful to sustain your programming. All right, okay, so I'm gonna jump this checklist question too, because I really, I need to share with you a very quick case study from the Algiers STEM Center. The Algiers STEM Center started in 2016 and it is reaching thousands of students and hundreds of volunteer educators and teacher training. Now, with the STEM Center in Algeria, we have gone through the different steps that we mentioned here, defining objectives. We made sure that we know where we are going, what types of students we want to actually offer activities for. On engaging others, engaging mentors, engaging students, university students in order to deliver activities, but also partners on the ground. Thinking logistics about the space where we do our activities in-house, where we do our field visits outside the STEM Center. Attracting participants so that they feel relaxed, they feel that the space is their space so that they can develop projects like Arslan here, developing his motion sensor product, and kids can get curious about the STEM Center activities. Planning, making sure that we plan each school break for activities so that we have our vision and our success framework in mind. Finding support through events, like here the opening events, inviting partners, US embassies, like embassies, in general, and also sustaining programming through camps, through caravans. So this is how the wheel keep turning, and going back to refining objectives, to engaging more partners, and to thinking about or developing or expanding on logistics, the space and the time, and also in our planning of activities. All right, so here I reach the end of the presentation. Please feel free to ask any questions in the very few minutes that are left. Yeah, so please feel free to put your question in the chat and I will be reading that. So how has the pandemic impacted your center's activities? Okay. Yes, so for the STEM Center, for the Riyadh STEM Center, we are at the launch, you know, the startup phase. So we are creating those partnerships. So the pandemic has slowed that down, but now with moving away from COVID-19, we're moving faster on the partnerships in Saudi Arabia. If we speak about the Algiers STEM Center, what happened is like with the lockdown and quarantine, teachers and mentors had that energy in them and they wanted to do something about that. So what they did is they filmed tutorials in their specific workshops and they shared those through live sessions, usually in the evenings. It happened during Ramadan of last year, so it was in the evening, in the evenings. Participants would participate in the Facebook Live, follow the tutorial live with the teachers, submitting their questions as comments, and then by the end building their projects and sharing it with the Facebook page. It was a fun time where participants were engaged, they were able to work on this project. The other good thing about it is that participants were able to get back to those videos that are recorded on Facebook. So this is one way that our colleagues at the Algiers STEM Center started doing activities during the COVID-19 pandemic. Another question I see is, what additional needs or challenges do it emphasis in the STEM Center needs to be primarily online for the foreseeable future. Yeah, so with the online, with the COVID-19, there was a surge of platforms where you can have activities done online and also for free. So the cycle or the spiral that I mentioned in one of the slides, starting from low or no resources activities to low resources activities can also happen and can happen online at no cost. So students can have access to those platforms. Probably if we get to the robotics section, we can have, we have to pay for licenses. But if we get all the other workshops like coding, even electronics, we can have those online on Tinkercad, for example, platform and other platforms that actually developed very quickly to serve people who are staying at home in their education. I hope that answers the question. Question from Bernard, what is your guiding principle of conducting activities, integrated learning, critical, creative, knowing, sustainable development, art, integrated learning, or if I understand the question correctly, the guiding principle for conducting activities. So I think this guiding principle is based in the objective of the STEM Center startup, that very question that we asked. So if we're raising awareness, if we're our objective is that students are curious about the STEM specialties and believe in their ability to take on those STEM specialties so that when they graduate or when they move on to post-secondary education in universities, colleges, or institutes, they are able to build their skills, develop their skills, and build their knowledge on that specific STEM specialty. So when it comes to that, I think I usually put it in Arabic, the translation is simplifying knowledge, simplifying science, I would say. Simplifying science is what guides all the activities that we conduct at the STEM Center, either be it like for students, directly for students, or for teachers. So when we work with teachers, we also work on the capacity of and the competencies of teachers that will allow them to simplify sciences for students and include all students in the classroom. I think that's the last question. Yeah. It's a comment from Sanjay. It's very interesting to learn about being in the STEM Center. Thank you. All right. I'm glad, Binod, that answers your question. Right. So thank you, everyone, for lending me your ears. Please feel free to contact Haley or contact me for any of the checklist questions if you'd like to see those. And we'll be happy to share the slides with you. Thank you, everyone. It was nice joining you in the session.